So welcome all. It's great to see so many people being here. And when I look outside, I see City Hall. So this is really a great venue, I guess, for giving this talk. I'm just going to talk a bit briefly about what the work is we're trying to do as data scientists for the city. And after that, we're just trying to quickly talk you through a few really practical cases of where we are applying data science or open source for the city. So really short about the city of Amsterdam. The organization, we have 15,000 and growing civil servants working for the city. Not all data scientists. I think that's a few hundred with data engineer and the whole team. And we have 820,000 inhabitants in the city and visitors and tourists, making it a really interesting place to work. The problems we mostly want to solve are around these topics, but these are just a few I think are really important. So sustainability, that sort of explains itself. Inclusive, I will talk more about this later. Mobility, getting rid of emission cars before 2030, that's gonna be difficult, and we're hoping to be able to help that with smart technologies. We always want to improve the livability. This is really vague and wide term, so hopefully from the examples you will understand what we mean. And for example, the issues with housing in the city is also something we want to help with. It's an example my colleague Swan always uses. You can choose what airliner you use, but you can't choose the city you live in. Well, some people can, but some people can't. But you can, however, choose in a democracy how this city is controlled. So over there in our city hall, people have been elected and they came up with guidelines on how we have to work with data. And this is the TADA manifest. This is basically 6 points that we want to do for our projects. The first one is that everything has to be inclusive. We want to take in consideration the difference between people and want to keep it all equal. The second one is we want the people to be in control of what we do with their data. We want it all to be tailored to the people. We want it to be legitimate and monitor it, open and transparent, and from everyone for everyone. So if you see this six a bit vague concepts, I think open source. So as a team, we really want to work as open source, do our projects open source. This is not always possible because we sometimes have really privacy sensitive data, and models for predicting fraud are probably not really easy to make open source, because if everybody knows how you're detecting criminals, then they're probably going to do their work a bit differently. But being transparent is really important, especially when you're making choices, for example, where somebody is being sent to school. You want to be able to explain why this choice was made, and I think making your source code open will really help with this. Another problem we have is technology works if it's scalable, if you can apply it worldwide. The problem with Amsterdam is that it's only a small part of the world. So having every city in the world develop their own techniques is probably not the way to really move forward fast. So with open source, we hope to be able to work together with other cities and communities like this. So these are the three cases we're going to talk to you about. The first one is routing and monitoring service requests. The second one is something we're doing with computer vision. And finally, a bit of an insight in what we're doing for digital housing fraud investigation. So the first one is routing service requests. What is a service request? Basically, somebody can go to our website or call our phone numbers and tell them there's an issue in public space. This might seem really simple, but these are only over 250,000 requests yearly. So on some days we have 1,200 requests coming in, really ranging from people on the street that are puking somewhere, pooping in front of somebody's house, people do weird shit, boats going too fast, boats making too much noise. There is 20 types of garbage I think we have to be able to detect. So that's complicated. These are some examples of over the 90 different categories we have. So homeless people, a container being full, container being broken, bridge, things with bridges, that's like a category. We have one for onkruid, and that's basically, in Holland we have rules for how many weeds can be on your sidewalk. And we as government have to make sure that there's not too much weeds on the sidewalk. So we have to be able to detect if somebody's talking about weeds, because legally we have to clean those. That's, yeah. But also animals and Well, basically anything that can be wrong in the public space, we have to be able to fix and have to be able to detect when somebody is asking us to fix it. This was like the old version. We asked somebody to pick it out of a list, which resulted in, well, the wrong things being selected. Somebody would say, oh, there is like garbage from a house outside. Can we clean this up? If this goes to the wrong category, we would send like a big garbage truck or like one of the swooping wagons to pick up bulky waste, like a couch, which does not really work well. So this is ineffective. You will get much more emission because you will drive twice. People will not be happy. So we were looking for a way to really effectively detect the topic of a service request, which resulted in basically, it's a really simple textual classifier trained on a lot of data. So I got a quick demo for this. It is in Dutch. Sorry for that. The data was in Dutch, so the model was also in Dutch. What it does is, so here I'm saying, er vaart een boot, which basically is there is a boat. It will detect why it's about something on the water. So that's quite well. It's still doubting about different types of problems on the water, but it's really neat that it's able to detect this. So if it's speeding, it will detect speeding. I'm not sure how many Dutch people are here, so how much I need to translate. But what it says now is there is a boat going too fast with too loud music, and we are able to just really detect what it is about and to see how to route this to the right department. But also, for example, if we see somebody saying there is garbage next to the container, basically, because of using such a model trained on the historical data, we know it's about household waste, this likely. You still don't know for sure. So we're working on implementing like geographical location or smart interfaces to just ask somebody what type of waste is this, is ask them to click on the right one. So it's this is implemented in the city right now. So we're using this for 250,000 issues a year, making it easier to, well, get the city to clean up the public space, and that's what we're for. So, another nice thing is when we detect the topic, that's the same example I use all the time, we can also immediately ask questions. So if we need to know a certain extra information, like when somebody is complaining about a boat, we need to know what sort of boat to be able to know what sort of department to send to fix it. So the goals of this project is making it easier to report issues, to route them more effectively, adding relevant information to the report, but also mainly it's to increase livability of the city, for cleaner streets, safer streets, etc. The future work, some of this is already done, but still needs to be implemented into organization, which is really difficult in an organization as the city of Amsterdam, which is quite an ancient organization, and working with data is all a bit woo. So we have to get everybody really happy to do these things. One of these is implementing detection of duplicates, which actually, there he is, an intern made for us 1 year ago. And now we're actually getting it implemented. Hopefully, being able to detect duplicates in these reports is about 15%, could save us 4 or 5 million euros a year. So this is really, it's quite a simple application, but the potential of it is huge. So if two people complain about the same thing, not just doing it twice, but doing it once and doing it better because you have more information. Also, we have a more multimodal classifier, which will also detect like the image you send, see what sort of garbage is on there, just to increase the accuracy of it even further. Something else we're trying to see if it's valuable is reporting with computer vision, so just taking a picture and detecting the topic. And for something like a noise complaint, this is mostly impossible. For a speeding boat, this is easier because you can see the boat. So we're just researching if this is a valuable addition to reach more people, because currently you have a lot of people that know how to make a report to the city, but these are like in specific neighborhoods. There are more people that know how to contact the city, and in some neighborhoods these people are not present. So there's like an inequality in how much help you get depending on where you live. And the ultimate goal is to prevent citizen reports and to just have the city brand spanking clean all year round. So a bit more the technical background. The really boring part is the best performing one is a TF-IDF with a logistic regression. We did a lot of deep learning, but it doesn't outperform on this data set. For the deployment in our system, it's really simple Flask API. The backbone of the system, so just the interface that's all connected to a Django with our users, where they can log in and see all the problems at the different departments. And we just put it all together with Docker all the time. The data, we have used about 500,000 service request data from old systems, and are currently keep on gathering new data. And here are some links. The slides will be shared, basically the source code of the application, of the classifier, a bit of a post of explaining how it's working. So if you're interested in it, you can look that up. It was like a one-day project, but I think it's really interesting because it really shows how open source can be used to quickly make something. We were looking for a way to real-time monitor the service requests coming in. So you have to imagine like there's a call center, there's about 10, 15 people working there all day, and a manager that's looking, is it going well? He had no idea. So we were looking for making like a quick real-time dashboard so you could see it all. This resulted in this. This is a tool called Tipboard, which has like this little DEX, and you can just use a REST API to send data to it. So we had one system which has an API, and you could just extract information and send it to this. So this was like an afternoon of work, and they're still using it, still running, going strong. So Tipboard is a tool, I can really suggest it to you. It's really a fun tool to just quickly make some real-time dashboard you can show on screens. I used FBProfit to do some predictions. So for example, this was today, this morning. We just used the time series to predict today probably there's going to be 470. But this is the coming week, so you know Monday is always a busy week. For some reason, on Monday, people report more things. Probably because they think we don't work in the weekends, but we do. We are here, so that's a lie. Okay. And this is a project I'm really enthusiastic about because it's nowhere near done, but I really would like to share it with you. We're using computer vision to detect garbage on the streets. As you can see, it's not perfect yet. But this is on a data set of 1,000 objects. So we're working on a bigger data set. It's already, we think, usable. What we want to do is basically start experimenting with using computer vision on the streets as a government. Because there's going to be some legal issues with this, we think. We just want to start doing this and see what's the reaction. We're going to drive around with cameras. Will people be happy about this? Will people maybe not be so happy about this? Can we assure privacy with projects like this? And what's, I think, interesting for a lot of people here is we want to annotate data sets and make these publicly available. So why would we pay for annotating and use it only ourselves? We're a public organization, so we're hoping to make really nice, high-quality annotated data sets and share these openly. And also experimenting with useful use cases, and eventually use this to increase livability and sustainability. Just a quick overview of what we have until now and what we're planning to do. So as I said, about 1,000 annotated objects. Really simple, fast RCNN, TensorFlow, pretend an ImageNet worked quite well. But we wanted to work better, be able to detect more different objects. So we're hoping to annotate a data set of 50,000 images that we have, make this public, get help with getting the best model possible. And we're also working together with the University of Amsterdam to get an infrastructure going that's capable of processing a lot of, basically streaming data coming from our vehicles, coming from our cameras. Oh yeah, this is a demo that's basically really version 0.01 of it counting because it's not working well yet. But we're looking for a way to effectively, with low computational cost, be able to count the garbage next to the street so we can map it and use this to plan the cars driving around. So for example, detecting the different types of trash is relevant. If you know where a washing machine is or a garbage bag, you can use this to send the right vehicles to the right location more effectively, drive less, use less energy, and clean it up in a way that's more sustainable. So that's another demo. This is just me on the bike, by the way, with my phone like this. So, so it's not done yet, but I think this is going to be in 10 years, probably if you have self-driving cars everywhere and scanning for other cars, and I hope also scanning for problems in the city so we can fix problems faster. So the possible implementations, as I said, reporting something to us by just using an image, so you don't even have to type. We want to put them on our different trucks. You know this one. This is driving around just scanning cars and see where they're parked. We just want to use the same camera to detect problems in the public space. And another one that is, who has ever been, how do you call it again, a speeding camera in English? Flitspaal, somebody? No, it's a Dutch invention, so when you're speeding, you'll get your ticket at home for speeding. We want to make the same thing, but then for garbage. So if you put garbage next to the container, it will just take a picture of you, and then you can... There's still some discussion with the legal department if this is okay, but we want to see if it's possible and what the reactions are. This is probably a cool experiment. So that's the one we're working on right now. I hope, hopefully in the next few months, we're going to have the first few data collection, have the pipeline ready. Because this is going to be the first experiment, which is going to be, I think, 12. It was 16 cameras, and we want to see if we can process these images real time. So thank God we can use the infrastructure of the University of Amsterdam. We have some nice NVIDIA GPUs I can use for this. And we want to use this to real time be able to control our fleet of garbage trucks. There's, I think, we're starting experiments in one neighborhood and we have 8 different types of garbage trucks. We're working on all the, we have 14,000 garbage containers for household waste in Amsterdam, I think even more. We're putting sensors in those to weigh when they are full. So we got this data real time, that's really cool data. I think it's even publicly available. The problem with this is, for example, you have one sensor that's weighing the container, does not detect if it's blocked. So you have a lot of people getting a lot of packages and just putting in the carton, and it will say it's not full, but somebody cannot put their trash in. So this is also a source we use, but we want to combine it all. So if you have a truck driving by that can see that it's blocked, then you have even more data, so you know.
I remember a story of someone lost.
Yeah, that's probably a bad idea. Well, if I was standing next to that, I will be able to detect, but detecting this for the whole city, maybe in the future. That's I think you need a lot of videos of people jumping into the containers for training data, I guess. the future for this, I already told you a bit. So we want to experiment with the applications to see what's possible. Is this really useful? Annotate a larger data set, make this public, and also make the models open source so they can use this in all cities all around the world, and we hopefully can use their models at our city as well. So I'm gonna give the microphone to my colleague Swan.
Yes, thank you. I'm going to tell you something about the project I'm working on. It's about digital housing fraud investigation. This morning we also had a presentation about fraud in the banking system, and it's really advanced. At the municipality we are really looking for what can we do? What do we want to do? So this is the first exploration of that topic. It's a very hot and relevant topic lately. It's a lot of in the papers. I don't know. So for the non-Dutch people, you have two types of housing. You have a social housing system. There are corporations. It's sort of semi, it's like public. And then you have the liberal housing, and a lot of the public housing, it's the social housing is cheaper, but it's also quite easy to fraud with it. So yeah, that's very undesirable. And we have different types of fraud. So we have illegal subletting. So for example, you rent it for a very low price and you just re-rent it to someone else for a normal price and you earn money with it. You have also a long-term vacancy. You would think, why would you do that? But actually it happens quite a lot. For example, if you want to move back to another country, but you still want to have a certain income, or you want to have the security of care in Holland, you have to have an address, so you keep your house, but you don't have anyone living into it. And then you have other type of unauthorized activities, like drugs, prostitution, and stuff like that. That's the main categories. And if we look at what do we investigate at the municipality, it's mainly illegal hotels for now, because it was really the focus point of the municipality for the last few years. But also there are some vacancy, prostitution, drugs. Yeah. So the goal of this project is to see how can we help the enforcements, like the housing fraud enforcements. For now, they are getting a signal, mostly from an ex or from a neighbor who thinking that person is really doing something they shouldn't do. They contact the municipality and we go there. So we want to support them to increase the efficiency and effectiveness, because this is a very labor intensive job to do. To decrease housing fraud and in the end really have appropriate housing for everyone in the municipality. So for now we get the signal. There's a little bit of documentation. They look at who owns this house. Then they do some manual prioritization. Not really. They're just thinking, okay, this looks quite good. I'm just going for this signal right now. They go to the house and do an inspection. Very often they have to go back multiple times because people are not home, and then you can just do, yeah, you can't do anything. And then there's a certain final conclusion. So what do we want to change? First of all, you could ask the question, do we really have to wait before someone is done with it and makes a signal? Or could we already see some cases before the signal is made? For example, if 20 people are living in a house which is only 40 square meters, you could already say, that looks really weird, let's check it out. So we are going to look if you can have some automated fraud signals. Then we will make the case more informed. So now our enforcement are going to the case quite uninformed. We want to give them more information about the property, about the people, the history, stuff like that, so they know what to expect and how to handle. Then we also want to prioritize, because we think, and we already see it now, that certain cases are way more interesting to look at. So it would be good to focus on those cases. And we also want to tell them and explain them why those cases came up with such a high chance of fraud. So they know why, so they can handle. And we are doing this mainly, so the housing department of the municipality has the data set. It was made for processing the way of working, but we can sort of see in how they work, which cases they looked into, and if they were fraud or if they weren't, and what type of category of fraud. So we use that as a base of our model to look at the historic cases and see what leads to fraud. Then we have Bach. So this one is not publicly available because it's very private, but then we have Bach data. It is publicly available. It's all kind of information about the house. So how big is the house? When was it built? On which floor is it? In what kind of neighborhood? Like all kind of characteristics of the house. Then we, as a municipality, scrape Airbnb data. For now, we're not doing anything with it, but we are trying to see if it can help us predicting which houses are which type of fraud. And the problem is that if we see a listing, but we don't know the exact address. So the matching is the problem, but we are looking into that now with a student also. Then we have more information about the people living at the address, like how many people? Is it a family? What is the, like, how are the they are registering? Did they register it all at once, or is it very does it fluctuate? We have information about the properties. So does someone owns other houses or other properties? And we have aggregated data about the neighborhood. So is it a very popular neighborhood for tourists? Are there a lot of students? Were there other problems? Like just aggregated neighborhood data. So this will be the base of the model we are now training. And it will look something like Funda, but then with listings, fraud listings, not so fun for Funda. But the idea will be the same. This will help the different enforcements choose on which listings they want to focus. And if you click on a listing, you see more information and more is coming up. So I really thought, do I have to talk privacy and ethics or not? And I decided not really to do it, because it would really be stupid to say, oh, we do privacy by design, and then I would go to another slide. So it's a very interesting project, but it's also very private. There's a lot of private data involved. So we are really careful about this. And we are working, for example, with a student, because you have all this more abstract ethic, like Maarten just talked before, like transparency, but how does that actually, if you look at the project, how can you apply that? And what can you do as a data scientist to make sure you're doing this the right way? So we have a master student AI who is going into this and help us to make it more applicable. And also a really important other thing in this project is the interoperability, and how that sometimes conflicts with the complexity you want to choose for your model. For this case, the overall interoperability is important, so we can see if the algorithm is transparent and stuff like that. But also the interoperability of a single case is important. So why did that specific case pop up, and what does that say to our enforcement? So you all, this is the more, I think you all know this picture, and I don't really like to see it as a trade-off, but there is for sure more effort you have to put into it to make it interpretable if you go into more complex models. For now, we are using random forest, and we are using several, it's called LIME, to see how can we make it interpretable. And if you are interested in it, please come to me afterwards, and I really like to talk about this topic more in more depth. So these are the first results. So if we are now doing the enforcements, we see in some of half of the cases there was actually housing fraud, and the other half it wasn't. And if we look at the model, at the precision, because it's quite important, it's really costly to go to a house, and it costs a lot of time and so money. So we would really like to see that the precision is quite good, and we see it, it's like 74%. So for now it's quite good, and we are really, in September we are going to start a pilot and really going to the addresses and see the actual results, because this is still, we are really looking forward to see how this works in the real life. Okay, so I hope you will remember, we are not Big Brother. It feels a bit like that, and it's always a thin line we have to walk as a municipality, but we are really open. Like, if you have any ideas, if you're interested, come to us. If you have ideas of new projects, it doesn't matter. Like, please come to us, help us, talk with us, and I hope you enjoyed, and you can go to meetups. We have every Thursday in Data Lab. There's a lot of data you can explore at data.amsterdam.nl. And thank you. If there are any questions, I would like to hear.